is a receptionist for an electronics company. Her ancestors were samurai. By night, when her workday is finished, she boards a train with her sword. Midori's father, Fumon Tanaka, is a grand master swordsman from Osaka, who has devoted his whole life to studying and practicing the fighting arts of the samurai.
I think many Japanese people can still find the spirit of the samurai in their hearts. We have started to judge everything with money, or if you own a big house or drive a nice car. But the spirit of the warrior was different. Honor was more important. To give your best at all times was important. This is the spirit of Bushido that we should not forget.
Today, his house is a haven for those who would follow this code. Midori visits three times a week to train. For the last 1,000 years, usually only men were trained in these martial arts. Midori started training when she was a small child and hopes one day to replace her father as grandmaster.
I think that we live now in a society where women don't have to hide anymore. But I don't feel that I have a special role in fighting school just because I'm a woman.
I want to pass on the knowledge that I received from my masters. And Midori is my only child. I was very happy when she decided to learn the old way of martial arts. If she hadn't gone this way, I'd have to choose somebody else to give my knowledge to.
Midori has advanced to the point where she now practices with a real sword, not a wooden one. This leaves no margin for error.
Through martial arts, you learn to overcome your fear. If you can reach the state of Mushin, which means no mind, you can be ready to fight at any time, even without fearing the possibility of death.
And who best to display this elusive mental state than the master himself? Tanaka prepares to show what the samurai meant by being at one with their swords and showing no fear. And why their lives depended on the quality of the blade. He will take the ultimate test when his daughter aims an arrow straight at his heart. Will his years of dedication and training protect him? Can his sword save him from a speeding arrow? Perfectly balanced and hard enough to cut through armor. In the hands of a fully trained samurai, the katana is the ultimate weapon for close combat. But what made the samurai and his sword a formidable fighting unit was this ability to not fear death. Samurai were trained in the art of meditation to reach a state of mind known as Mushin. Fumon Tanaka now faces his daughter's arrow. In a contest against the bow and the sword, these lethal arrows can penetrate a board over 1 centimeter thick, more than enough to kill a man. It's not only Master Tanaka's ability to react in the face of a speeding arrow aimed at his heart, but also the sharpness of his sword that means he stands a chance of being able to sever it in mid-flight. samurai's katana is proof of man's ability to strive for perfection. It is the culmination of generations of swordsmiths working across hundreds of years in a pursuit for the finest blade in the world. And these swords didn't go unnoticed when American troops occupied Japan during the Second World War. During the war, thousands of Japanese officers had a sword. Even kamikaze pilots died with them by their sides. So great was the demand for these warriors' weapons that the sword went into mass production. They were mostly poor quality imitations, not made in the traditional way, but merely drop forged from cheap steel. Although it's just possible that some true katana swords made it across enemy lines.
When the war ended, a large number of Japanese swords were surrendered or confiscated from Japanese prisoners or from the dead on battlefields. And just as the Japanese were very loath to part with them, so American GIs were very eager to acquire them. But among the hundreds of ordinary swords that were taken back to the States as souvenirs, there were a certain number of national treasures, ones made, if you like, of imperial quality. And who knows how many of these treasures actually lie in American homes that were taken back without the owner knowing what a prized possession he'd acquired.
Over half a century later, the katana remains the finest sword ever made. It's an object of great beauty, a symbol of honor. Although these ancient values have modern-day price tags, the Chuken Shibata Gallery in Tokyo proudly displays its samurai swords. Perfection comes at a price, starting at around $5,000 to $25,000 for a good sword, and rising to over $50,000 for a famous one. Even if you can afford one, gallery owner Mr. Shibata doesn't sell to just anybody.
Maybe I'm old-fashioned, but the sword is still the soul of the samurai. I don't sell them to just anyone. It's important for me to get an understanding of the client, to feel like I can trust them.
It's now 3 months since Gasan Sadatoshi finished forging his sword. Master Hanami, the polisher, is also done. It's the moment of truth. Time to inspect the results of half a year's work involving 15 men.
A sword that I spent so much time on to see it finished, with all its characteristics brought fully to light. It leaves me speechless.
Made in the 21st century by strictly traditional methods, this katana sword is the embodiment of centuries of knowledge. In one perfect blade, it combines the resilient soft qualities of iron with the hard, razor-sharp finish of steel. The polish, both exquisite and lethal, for many, it's the hand weapon of choice.
To me, the Japanese sword is the most effective sword in the world.
In my opinion, the Japanese samurai sword is the finest sword ever made.
Even today, the samurai and his way of life continue to inspire new generations. 1,000 years of discipline, unswerving devotion, and fearless skill are values that Japan still holds high. And the legend of the katana sword lives on.